Hello everyone, I am Rajeshwari Moganti, Professor at the Department of Biochemistry, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi. Now, this module is M25 on isothermal calorimetry in the paper 3, that is on thermodynamics. In the previous module, we have understood what is calorimetry and how to measure the macroscopic changes. If there are macroscopic changes in the heat changes in a reaction, that can be studied like combustion, etc., by a simple bomb calorimeter. But normally, the biological reactions are do not give such large heat changes. So, very subtle and small amounts. So, that you need to use microcalorimetry. So, that is why the ITC actually popularly known as ITC, isothermal calorimetry, determines the small little changes in biological reactions. So, why use ITC, why not any other method? So, there are number of advantages of ITC in studying the heat changes for biological systems. That is, it is completely general technique. It can be ITC measures the production of the heat changes, which can be used in a very simple manner. That is one thing. And also, the technique of choice for affinity of the measurements. It could be neutral or it could be unmodified change reaction, protein or any molecule biopolymer need not be modified. And the ligand binding can be studied, or it can bind a substrate, enzyme substrate can be studied. So, any biological reaction irrespective can be easily studied by using ITC. Now, this also does not require any immobilization or any labeling. So, you just do it in a very natural system without disturbing the structure or the sequence or the conformation of any protein or a DNA. So, that is a great advantage, because you are actually dealing with the natural system in its own functional, its natural functional conditions. Now, there is also equally useful for macromolecules and small molecules. You can use it for ligands also if there are small change, but primarily many biological reactions you use a macromolecule and a small molecule interaction, or only macromolecule. Also, this is compatible with essentially you can use any buffer or any additive. So, there is no problem in using any medium or the solvent. Also, the reactions can be conducted isothermally at any temperature below 2 to 80 degree centigrade, between 2 and 280 degree centigrade. Obviously, you won't go below 2 because it will create frozen and then generates the moisture and other things, but otherwise normally it is used between 2 and 80 degree centigrade, where TM etc. can also be studied. So, with this the background, the objectives of the module are laid out. That first thing, what is isothermal calorimetry? I'll give an introduction. Then, of course, power compensation. What do you understand? Because when you are measuring a isothermal change, keeping the temperature change, you need to give a power compensation. What is the theory and principle? And of course, technical and instruction details of how to do the experiment and how do you analyze this data. Once you get it, what are the equation, how do you analyze this data? That is more important than doing an experiment. Then also types of experiment that can be addressed by the ITC. So, with that introduction, this is primarily more of a theory and introduce you to the technique on isothermal calorimetry. So, what are the types of experiments that are addressed by the ITC? Binding between macromolecules, it could be a polymer, any biopolymer, DNA, protein or lipid. Binding constant can be determined. Also, you can use a stoichiometry, that what is the ratio of A to B in a reaction, how many molecules of protein, how many molecule of ligand, you can determine how many are bound. Then also you can determine obviously the enthalpic changes, and based on the enthalpy you can determine also the entropy. Now, we using enthalpy and entropy, obviously you will determine the free energy. So, what you can determine between a macromolecules, binding constant, stoichiometry, enthalpy, entropy and free energy. I mean, that's really almost all the parameters of any thermodynamic, any biological reaction you would be getting it directly from ITC. Also, one important thing I would like to mention here is that ITC gives direct heat changes, whereas when you use UV or absorption spectroscopy, also you can determine binding constant, you can determine stoichiometry, but they are all indirect methods because you are using the absorption changes and then converting them into the binding constant. Therefore, the ITC has to, calorimetry is a very big advantage because you are directly measuring the heat changes. The number two point is the binding to complex macromolecular targets. If they are higher order complexes or liposomes or ribosomes also can be studied, not just 1:1, you can have a multi-component system also. Then the third one is a material association. If there is any aggregation or multimer formation, dimer, trimer, that also can be studied. Then the computation experiments can be done, enzyme kinetics can be done. So, a lot of reactions that are usually required in a biological experiments can almost do everything in using the ITC. That is a gate advantage. The power compensation principle, which is briefly mentioned in the previous module, but actually here it is in a much more sophisticated, much more sensitive, much more carefully done here, because this process actually proceeds, a temperature difference is created between the sample and the reference side of the calorimeter, and this temperature difference is actually compensated by electrical heaters placed at the sample and reference ampoules. This is what I have shown in the diagram. If you see, there is a thermometer that measures the changes, and there is a power compensation is done by a thermocouple, and that change in the depending on the reaction, whatever difference in the change heat change occurs, power is compensated, and that is measured by the amplifier. So the electric power input to maintain the equal temperature is actually equivalent to the measured signal, and that is in turn equivalent to the heat change that are happening in that particular reaction. So this is grossly the principle. This is one of the instruments. There are very few companies that make this ITC, but this is one of them, and I do not want to mention the company name, but this is generally the equipment that looks like. These are the different parts: power compensation, platinum thermometer, and then there is a thermostat and capillary where you put the sample there. So, this is the ITC burette and titration syringe you see here. This is actually embedded with a linear alkylator, and this syringe is actually have a threaded syringe mount where you actually put the sample, introduce the sample to the tube. And it has a twisted stirrer paddle also, and this spring is shown here, which you can actually loaded electronic connections for wire free operation. This is very easy and very carefully it should be used. This precautions I will mention later. So the standard volume is actually 1 ml. So you use about 100 microliters to 250 microliter syringe, and there is another one which you really need to use very precious samples, blood samples, then you use low volumes, like for example 200 microliters to 50 microliter syringe. This is the titration syringe. You can see much more closely, and the sample, when you load it, it is very, very important, crucial that the sample doesn't have air bubble. You can see that air bubble is actually shown to make you appreciate that kind of problems can occur. So air bubble is actually showing here only for your demonstration. This is a 100 microliter syringe. Now this is how you fix the burette and syringe, assemble the burette and syringe. Loading of the sample into the reference cell, this is shown here. The sample and reference cell actually configure in this round this thing, and center is the one where actually you keep the sample. The cell filling, the cell inside has to be cleaned properly, and then filling will be done with the syringe, like a Hamilton syringe. So this is the how it looks like ITC cell design. These are the conical tops and bottoms promote the constant bubble free filling, uniform stirring and easy cleaning. These are the three critical things, that there should be bubble free and stirring should be uniform. So the change, reaction change, heat change occurs has to be, whole solution should be in uniform because you are measuring the temperature and keeping the thermocouple inside. And also it has to be clean, not that previous sample is left over, that gives a lot of errors. Now the cylindrical cells are made of chemically inert substance like 99.999% pure gold. Gold is normally used, but sometimes Hasselroy is also used. Now Hasselroy is also another inert one, it is used mostly in industry. This is actually a nickel and molybdenum alloy. You can also use gold, normally either gold or these two are used. But why they have to be so pure? Because they should not, they have to be firstly inert, that they themselves don't interfere with the reaction that's going on. So that's very, very critical. And then of course inert plus any impurity within the metal will can also lead to, they do not, but even the impurity can react. So that's very important. Now this is a setup where the ITC is ready for titration. That is, the burette with injection needle is shown here into the top of the calorimeter, and then just generally push the handle towards. These are actually will be shown more in a detailed manner, practical in the next module. So once you have done, that's not a problem, that you have once done the, once loaded the sample, how do you run? That software has a number of parameters. It is actually, any instrument offers a lot of flexibility and parameters to the user, not just the default conditions, because normally people use the default conditions used by the previous researcher. But I would suggest that every time you use, you need to have your own conditions your own conditions. So this is how it looks like. A stirrer speed can be maintained, and the syringe, how much volume you are filling and what is the temperature you are starting. You can, depending if it is a small molecule or is not a protein but it is a small peptide, they melt very at a low temperature. So you can start temperatures below 15, or if you start at 15 degree centigrade, or otherwise if it is a macromolecule you can start at 25. So this temperature I shown you here, you normally at the room temperature. Then you type this experiment, what you are doing, going to do, whether it is can be a continuous term or it is in a different, what kind of incremental are you going to do a titration and do small amounts, what kind of experiment. These are shown here, three types: incremental and continuous titration or electrical pulses. Which one you want to do, you can set it up as per your requirement. Once you give these, feed these conditions, of course there is also important that you do the baseline. This is how you get the baseline, and are also called the integration settings. So this is a baseline editor slide where you use the try to see first only the solvent or buffer. If you are going to do the experiment in a buffer, so you just run the buffer and that is how it looks. So this has to be used as a baseline. This is one ITC data analysis, one of the softwares, the number of them. So as I told earlier, that if you are using the ITC data fitting models, if you are using a experiment with a biopolymer and a small ligand, ligand could be a drug, it could be any metal ion or anything else, then there are different methods to use. One is independent fitting model, that means the drug does not depend on the site, but it independently binds to any site of the protein or a biopolymer. The second is a minimized independent. It independent, but independency is minimized, not to a large extent. Then the third one is more important, which is also very common, multiple sites. It can have more than one site, and each site may bind with a different kind of binding constant. So one site can be a higher binding site, second one can be different binding sites. Then of course you do the blank, which is a linear, which has to be linear. Then also blank, which can be a constant, or if there is a dimer dissociation. So these are the things which actually data can be fit to different conditions, which sample are you dealing with. Now also you can determine the statistics on these results. Using this, you can determine the binding constant, delta H, that is enthalpy change, N is the number of sites of the drug or a ligand bound on the biopolymer. So if there are 10 sites, then 10 molecules can bind onto the biopolymer. Therefore, user can adjust these fitting interactions, and also confidence interval calculations can be done. Visual graph of fitting the interaction results can be done. Statistics results can be done using delta K and delta H and N. Now, the third important thing is a flexible overlay graphing. Flexible display of multiple graphs can be done, and now you can determine you want to appreciate or you want to make understand that with the comparison with two different drugs, you can do the display of multiple graphs. User also can select the format, the type of graph you want to export. So these are all the things that are available within the software. So how do you analyze these fitting models? You can using these conditions, you can use a independent multiple site competitive displacement also can do it. If there are two competent ones, one displaces the strong one, displaces the weaker one to the same site, not a different site. Two different sites is different because two binding molecules, two ligands can bind two different sites. But competitive displacement, when I say, what I mean is the same site with two different ligands competing to the same site. Then there is a dimer dissociation, the same molecule form under dimers can be formed, or a can have also linear plot. So this kind of things can be used using this software. Then you analyze the data and modeling can be done. The calorimetric data are normally interpreted through binding models. The experimental result supports whatever model that fits the data best. So you have to give what data actually it is fitting with and try the data is fitting with this models, one model, one binding model, two or competitive and so on and so forth. So and then it gives you one best fit data. Then note that the chosen model does not prove a certain mechanism, but it merely supports it. So no mechanism, no chemical reactions or the anything is taken into consideration here. It just gives it heat changes, and with that heat changes it tries to fit the data, which whether it is a one binding site model or multiple binding site model. So no mechanism is actually is supported or suggested using this data. This is just to show the statistics of this, how your data is fitting with the example is shown here in this case, and is an independent binding site model. Here actually again giving a kind of theory, enthalpy and entropy compensation is there. Favorable, the what are the things that actually favor the hydrogen bonds and conformational changes, and then sometimes they are dominated by the hydrophobic changes. What is the one that is here I have shown you the delta G as a black box, the free energy which actually derives from delta H and T delta S, delta G equal delta H minus T delta S. So delta G can be same, but at the same time delta H and contributions from enthalpy entropy can be totally different. So the favorable hydrogen bonds and hydrophobic interactions can be different. So when we talk of entropy, always it's been mentioned so much in the first three modules that positive value is favorable because entropy of the universe is increasing. So hydrophobic interactions always contribute to entropy. And whereas the hydrogen bonds directly associated with to number and strength of hydrogen bonds actually contribute to enthalpy. So the negative enthalpy and positive entropy actually leads to change in the free energy. And choice of the solvent is also important in case of the enthalpical reactions. Whereas in entropy, the solvation is really important. I mean, solvation actually plays a role in contributing to the entropy, where because of the release of water molecule, the entropy changes, and that's how the free energy changes, and therefore the delta the heat changes will also be different. The conformational degrees of freedom, these kind of things actually contribute to particularly to entropy. So this is one thing, as this is of course one of the technical point I would like to make, that the, because whatever you are measuring, whatever you are analyzing is all dependent on the heat change quantitative measurements, and quantitative measurements have to be accepted with a pinch of salt. If your cell is not clean, if your experimental methodology is wrong and you are not doing in a proper condition. So the whole thing depends on how clean is your sample, how carefully you load the sample. So that's why I mentioned fuse precautions here, that fill the sample with a concentrated solution of sodium hydroxide for normal sodium, and then clean it completely, because so that the previous sample, whether it is a DNA or a protein, is thoroughly removed, and then rinse with water continuously as so much as of 1 liter. This is a sample, the instrument provides that. So you thoroughly clean that so that it is completely lost. Then of course, once you remove with acid base, then again remove with nitric acid, again wash it, and then both the cells have to be degassed, deionized water. So the degassing is important, because so that there is no dissolved oxygen in the water, and also deionized water, ions contribute lot to the charge and therefore they also react. So these are the 2-3 important things one has to measure, one has to take into account while doing the ITC. After doing so much and mentioned so many advantages of ITC, nevertheless each technique has its own disadvantages and limitations. Now some of them are that actually you use a lot of material. If you are dealing with a biological sample, and especially if it is a pathological sample, you are really restricted to get enough amount of a DNA or any protein or whatever. So therefore, the one of the restriction is that, the limitation is that it needs a lot of material. Also washing is also very, you know, tedious and tidy laborious one, and you have to be really clean, keep a clean sample, clean cell. So these are 2 things. In addition, of course, degassing, even if your cell is clean, if you have lot of gas, dissolved oxygen, that's very, very important. At least about hour you have to remove the air from the dissolved oxygen by degassing, which comes with the unit, comes with the instrument. The third greatest limit, these are the technical stuff, but intrinsically the method has some limitation, that if the heat changes of the complex reaction are very strong binding one, like more than 10 kilocalories, then actually the measurements of the binding constant cannot be measured, because it is so high that it is not possible. Whereas this has an advantage with the next technique we will be talking, that is a differential scanning calorimetry. So the very high binding constant, more than 10 to the power 9 moles, you cannot really accurately measure using ITC. So this is one of the, tight binding cannot be analyzed by ITC, but tight binding can you analyze. Tight binding means binding constant is very high, 10 to the power 9 moles, that cannot be used by ITC, but you can use DSC. Of course, the advantage, as I mentioned, that you can use for a weak binding molecules, that is very good. So with that, I will give you the summarize the things we have studied in this module. That is, in ITC I introduced you what is isothermal calorimetry, then what is the principle behind this experiment, this technique, and what kind of limitations are there and what are its advantages. So isothermal calorimetry, and also you can use it for differential titration calorimetry. This is actually a simple analytical technique using for the quantitative chemical titrations, which can be any titrant, which could be any analyte, it could be any kind of a biological reaction. And then a single titration experiment that offers direct determination of thermodynamic parameters. Here you are not determining by any other indirect method, directly you are determining the heat change, so that the KD, the binding constant, or the KD, the dissociation constant, delta H are actually directly coming. So, it has much more reliable than compared to any indirect method like in UVA visible absorption spectroscopy, where you determine the absorption and then convert it into determine the free energy, and from free energy you will determine the K. So, it has it. So, when you determine same K from K of a same reaction between two techniques, it is always ITC is preferred because it is a direct measurement. So, that is very good thing about ITC. Nevertheless, then you can use it for identify whether the reaction is entropically driven, enthalpical driven. Then also it is used for binding of small molecules with any drug or any small metal ion, any other ligand to any macromolecule or a protein or a DNA or anything. So, ITC, because of its limitation, because it needs a lot of material, that is one thing. Sometimes it is not possible, then also time taking and care has to be taken. With all these limitations, sometimes it becomes, it can lead to kind of sometimes false positive or false negative experiment results. So, one has to do it in a very careful manner. And also the limitation is its intrinsic sensitivity. It is very, very highly sensitive. At its advantage, at the same time disadvantage if you do not do it properly. Then it is not capable of measuring the binding constant of very, very high. It is good for a weak binding or a small binding constants, like it, then it is very good. You can determine for a multiple binding sites, independent binding sites, or even a competitive binding sites, that is all very good. But if it is a very high binding constant, ITC is not very useful. So, with that, I close this module on ITC. Thank you.